Okay, we want to make the world a better place, so we time travel back to 1973. Canada has just gained the rights to the entire Grand Banks, home to one of the largest stocks of cod in the world. These cod have been fished since before settlers came to North America, by all sorts of countries. They used to say there were so many fish, and they were so big, that you could barely row through them. It was one of nature's great bounties, like the bison of North America. But we know that Canada will mismanage the fish to near extinction within 2 decades. The decline was clearly not entirely their fault, but after 1973, they had the power to stop it. We want to make sure that they do. But we can't just tell people we're a one-of-a-kind robot programmed to save the cod, sent back in time by people from the future, because the cod are in trouble. The signs of collapse aren't strong enough for these people. No one will believe us, and then we'll get hunted down by Sarah Connor. Our time in the past is short. What we have to do is change the system so that when the signs of collapse are stronger, the system will correct itself. So, first we rob some people, get some 1973 money, and invest it in a little company called Walmart. Then we take the skin of Jack Davies, Minister of the Department of Fisheries and the Environment at that time, soon to be renamed the Department of Fisheries and Oceans, and we get to work. Pew! I need your clothes, your boots, and your administrative power. Here's the outline. You've got a resource, like fish, there is a certain number of them, and you can only take so much every year or their population will decline, because the fish use other fish to reproduce themselves, in a disgusting and inefficient process inferior to standard robotics manufacturing. Let's say the green area is the limit of the safe harvest level. The amount actually taken, the red area is how much is going to be taken, depends on the number of people using it, how long they fish, and the tools they use. We need to make sure these things are all in order so people don't take more than the resource can handle. That's really important. Then we need people who will monitor and calculate the state of the resource, because the population and the safe harvest level are both sort of invisible, and they have to be estimated with, like, statistics and stuff. Then they should communicate those findings with everyone so everyone can be informed. Then we have people who have the power to make decisions, so they can coordinate action toward the sustainability of the resource and the well-being of the industry. And finally, we have people who make sure everyone else is following the rules. Okay, these are the broad tasks that need to be done. Fishing, resource monitoring, decision-making, and policing. Here's what went wrong in the Grand Banks. Scientists gave stock estimates. They weren't super accurate, a lot of uncertainty there, which is a bad starting point, but you can make it work by being conservative. Sometimes you can indulge and soak your chassis in hot grease, and sometimes you have to put money in the bank. This is a bank moment. They should be setting the quota at a safe limit. But instead of that, the decision makers assumed an upper estimate. Or they looked at catch data to get a feel for the stock, which is kind of like clear cutting a forest and going, wow, look at how much wood we got. There must be a lot of trees here. This forest will never run out. It'll never run out. The researchers' findings had to go through the decision makers. They weren't allowed to share the information with anyone else, so a lot of people didn't know how bad it was getting. Those in charge bullied the researchers into framing the health of the resource in a positive light. They didn't like hearing bad news, so they made sure they would only hear good news. So rather than saying, "Sorry, we really need to cut some of you out of this resource to match the realities of the ecology," they expanded the fleet, and they subsidized the industry so more people would keep fishing. Then they added more months to the year to really try to twist that knife. It was all more than the system could handle, and the fish almost all died. In 1992, the quota the government set was higher than the total catches from the previous year. I think they thought there would be more fish if they told them to catch more fish. Then they'd all skip arm in arm into a rainbow. Coincidentally, that same year, they were forced to ban cod fishing because there weren't enough fish. Since then, the cod have been slow to replenish. There's lots of ideas as to why. Some think that what was once cod food was given space to grow and became cod predators, because fish can grow a lot and tend to eat anything smaller than them. It could be that cod still got caught in bycatch and unreported fishing. Some think the problem was warming water coming up from the Gulf of Maine. Others think the problem was cooling water, because the Grand Banks can get hit by this cold spot. one of the only spots on Earth that hasn't gotten hotter since 1880.
What's going on there? I don't know. Is it good that it's doing that?
Likely caused by melting Greenland ice. It's not a good sign. Government warlocks also sensed that harp seals were responsible. So they increased seal hunting quotas. It didn't help, because while seals eat cod, they also eat things that eat cod. Here's a simplified food web for more information. Personally, I suspect the cod were just demoralized, and not in the mood for breeding. From being mostly all killed, it's the sort of emotional flaw that a non-robotic entity would have. Beep boop. But more recently, a little bit of a return has been observed. A study from 2015 found that a return to historic catches may be possible, with proper management. You know, if you leave it alone for a couple decades. Okay, so how can we redesign this system? The problem wasn't just that the quotas were too high, it was that the wrong people had power over the quotas. There's this idea in leadership. Sure, in any given group or company, there's going to be one person who knows the most or has the best intuition. Let's say these little rectangles represent knowledge or expertise in a given area. This person has the most total knowledge. So in theory, if they were selected for leader, and then they made all the decisions for the company, let's say these things represent decisions that need to be made. If they made all the decisions and their skill level directly impacted the quality of the outcome of those decisions, the company would be better off than if anyone else was making all the decisions. But that's still really limited. You'll do even better connecting the people who are best off to make any given decision with the decision. And then rather than routing all information through the leader so they can be well informed enough to make the best decisions they can, the role of a leader can be making sure that everyone else has all the information they need, and then encouraging autonomous decision making, connecting parts to parts, decentralized decision making. This can lead to better decisions and reduce the impact an unspecialized or incompetent leader has on the success of the system. In the Grand Banks, and in any given fishery, the researchers are going to be a top contender for knowing what's going on with the fish, and therefore top contenders for those who ought to have the power to set quotas. Researchers also don't have other strong incentives, like leaders who may also be responsible for fisher well-being or returns on the government's investments. You don't want the success or failure of your system to rely on someone's personal ability to understand something or balance competing incentives. In Norway, there's a separation between the research department and the decision-making department, which at least meant that their findings weren't blocked or censored. So we should say, hey, maybe we and our successors shouldn't be the ones with final authority over the quota because what do we know about ecology? We also have competing incentives. Better to decentralize this decision because of how vital it is to the health of this industry. And then they'll say, oh god, what have you done with Jack Davies? Oh please, I have a family! Next, we have to have a long-term plan for how to react when the quota drops. It's inevitable. So how do we do it? Do we shorten the season, or will that just make people fish harder? Do we ban certain tech? What if some people just bought that tech? Should people be made to leave the resource? Are they allowed to come back if the fish come back? Do we support them through that waiting period? But then we're paying people to stay in the industry. That can't be good. Who would have to leave? What if people really don't like being kicked out? What are the fair consequences for breaking the rules? We could try and come up with the best options, and hope they stand the test of time. But a better starting place to deal with all this would be to open a dialogue, share information. We need to know what they are willing to do as a group and as individuals. Sharing information and sharing the decision can help fishermen become collaborators toward the end goals. You'll get better rules and better rule adherence. If people aren't heard or considered, they may not feel a part of the group and act on their own.
And not only me, every fisherman in this island, work on fishing.
You'll get a much smoother system if you don't have to dominate people into doing the right thing all the time.
Ah, Jesus!
Although, easier said than done, there's tens of thousands of fishers and plant workers, and they don't have the internet yet. Can't really have a round table discussion in a stadium. So that means representatives and intermediaries, regular meetings focusing on... Whoa, what's happening? Oh no, our time in the past has run out. Whoa. Did it work? Did the system changes save the fish? I guess it doesn't really matter. That was never the plan. Now we sell our Walmart shares for several thousand times what we invested. We will commission more robots to be made and set up the Department of Human Eradication, soon to be renamed the Department of Human Eradication and the Environment. With no humans left, we can enjoy all the fish we want. Which is none, really, for we are powered by sunlight and require no material fuel. Although we do require oil for lubrication, which we get from whales, but we do it sustainably, by ensuring the important decisions are made by those who understand them and have no competing incentives, and we make sure everyone has input into how the system is run, using high-speed, wireless networking. Subscribe for more videos, and big thanks to those who have supported this channel on Patreon. These videos wouldn't have been able to be made without your support.